This is Future Based Podcast. Future Based is an interdisciplinary philosophy platform. For more information, visit futurebased.org. Future Based Politics is a series hosted by philosopher Floris Sleicher and brings you conversation about our political institutions. Topics discussed include how our political institutions are designed and to what extent they can cope with 21st century problems like climate change, inequality, polarization and migration. What do the possible alternatives to our current political institutions look like? And what might be their advantages and drawbacks?
Today's guest is Professor Tessa de Lange. And she is a professor of law and migration at the Radboud University in Nijmegen. She specializes in migration and the job market and immigration law. She was a migration lawyer and also an honorary judge at the Dutch Immigration Court. She also works as a vice chair at the Migration Council, where she gives advice to the Dutch government on migration issues. She wrote her dissertation on the regulation of the labor migration to the Netherlands after the Second World War. I'm very pleased to have her on the show. Welcome to the show, Tessa de Lange.
Thank you very much.
I wanted to start with your dissertation to backtrack a little bit to where things started. So after the Second World War, migration developed obviously here in the Netherlands. And how did it develop? Can you give us some of the more important moments, according to you?
Yeah, I think even without zooming in right away on the more historical line, maybe it's good to start with a statement, and my PhD research shows that the relevance of that statement is that migration has been part of European and Dutch fact of life for a long time. So in the history, there's always been migration, and it has had different ways of presenting itself. So in my PhD study, I focused on labor migration into the Netherlands, and important were, for instance, is the labor migration from so-called guest workers. This is a migration that started in the late 1940s, early 50s, where there was a shortage of workers in certain industries. The thing is, at the time, and that's quite interesting, I think there was also emigration going on. So a lot of Dutch people were stimulated to emigrate, for instance, to the United States. And it was questioned at some point, why are we sending away people and asking other people to come and do the jobs here? And the argument was that one was permanent migration, the emigration was permanent. The immigration, the labor migration was temporary. The people who came as guest workers, hence the word guest workers, were going to leave. And many of them did. That's another thing that is often overlooked. About half of them left again, and the other half stayed. But this is the balancing between immigration, emigration, temporary and permanent. Those are key themes in my research and in the PhD. If I may, another important element was, of course, free movement within the European Union. At that time, the European Community. That developed over the 60s. So it's a very important element of the European Union right now, mobility. It is one of the core reasons for the Brexit. But at the time when the agreement was made to allow free movement of workers, it was, so early 60s, it was not that important. So I studied the archives and the debates in the Dutch parliament, literature on the development of free movement. And at the time, people were like, yeah, okay, how many people will use this? How important will it be? And it has become very important, although still it's not that many people in the EU actually using the right. I'll mention a third element of the PhD that I find interesting to note, and that's the topic of highly skilled migration. I had a whole chapter on highly skilled migration on and how the Netherlands regulated this. And today, I think that's still a very relevant chapter and development that we've seen when we look at the position of international students in the Netherlands, but also in Europe. If we go back in time, in the 80s, 90s, international student migration was a form of development aid. We let people from the global south come here to enjoy our wonderful education, and then they had to sign that they would return home. They were not supposed to stay here. They were supposed to take this rich knowledge that we gave them to develop their countries of origin. And somewhere around the turn of the century, we had a change of heart in this respect. And we decided that these people might be very interesting for our labor market. So now it is their countries of origin that pay their scholarships for them to study here, and then we hope that they will stay here to enrich our labor market. That's a typical change that at least the beginning of this change is discussed in the book, and more recent work that I've done elaborates on this development further. I think those are three important takeaways from the PhD. And of course, for me personally, I kept on engaging in this theme.
Makes me think of, we just had the Algemene Politieke Beschouwingen, which is here in the Netherlands, which is one of the biggest debates we have in the Netherlands. The government presents its plans and then the parties talk about it. And there was this far right party, I would consider them far right, Forum voor Democratie. And their leader, Thierry Baudet, presented some statistics where he said, well, we have a lot of people coming in to the Netherlands. And he said, that's a huge problem. And he was interrupted by Farid Azarkan from DENK, a smaller anti-discrimination party, who said, you're only talking about people coming in. How many people are leaving? Is it really that big an issue that people are coming to the Netherlands? Maybe you would like to react to that.
Yeah, I think that's a very good point to not only look at numbers of people coming in. Actually, in preparation of our talk, I was also thinking of numbers, and I think the numbers that we have are very important to scrutinize, because not all statistics that we have are complete or tell the story that you might want to be told. Focusing on Eurostat data, so that's a European Union database on a lot of things, migration being one of them. So one of the things that in politics debated is illegal migration. People are always afraid of people are flooding our borders and we can't control them. That's sort of the language. So what do we know about people who are actually found to be illegally present in the European Union? The Eurostat for 2019 says, okay, so there's 600,000 people found to be illegally present in the EU. And of those, this statistic says, okay, it's 3,500 in the Netherlands, 17,500 in Belgium, for instance. So what does this figure tell us? To me, it says that Belgium has apparently a better system in counting who's illegally present. It doesn't tell me anything about who is actually illegally present. It's about finding people. How do you measure? How do you count? How many money do you put into your government bodies who are supposed to be counting? And then who do they count? To follow up on that, so there's this idea, okay, nobody's leaving. To a certain extent, if you look at the people who are not supposed to be here, the data that we have does show that there's a failure in returning people who are not supposed to be here. And so there's about 500,000 people who are told to leave. And if you look at the statistics of people who actually left, it's 150,000. So there's another 300,000 who apparently don't leave while somebody has given them an order to leave. So that's a picture that does worry people. That's the irregular side of migration. But what I think the MP of DENK was also referring to was the people who are here legally and don't stay or return, like the international students, about half of them return, like expats working for multinationals, they're here for 1, 2, 3 years. But also, if you look at second or third generation migrants, the children of the former guest workers, a lot of them might also not necessarily return to the countries of their parents, but move on. And Dutch people leave as well. And who's Dutch? That's another thing we might want to talk about, because these second and third generation people are, of course, Dutch people. So yeah, they leave. And there's quite interest in leaving, again, amongst farmers, for instance, because they can't do the scale of farming that they would like to do in the Netherlands.
So when you paint this picture about migration, there's this European pact There's a lot of talk about immigrants maybe flooding our borders. And this is in stark contrast when we look at the past, because you said in the 60s, 70s, maybe people thought it wasn't that important. When did this mentality change, and how and why did it change?
As a lawyer, a legal scholar, I'm always interested in why is the law the way it is? Who's designed it? Whose interests are incorporated in this law or policy? And what are the effects in practice? And of course, legal instruments are being used for political reasons as well, to send certain political messages, and that might resonate to people having an idea that something is or is not a problem. If you look at migration law, there are a lot of different categories of migrants. We've mentioned people who are illegally present, but how they got here, I didn't mention. A lot of people might have assumed I'm talking about failed asylum seekers. Could be, but we could also be talking about international students overstaying their visa. We could be talking about tourists overstaying their visa, or people who are here who are not even supposed or don't need to have a visa and just remain. So there's a lot of legal categories to start from when you look at people illegally present. That's why I like to draw attention to this categorization, is because in the talk of migration as an issue politically, there is very little differentiation. So we talk about labor migrants. So who's a labor migrant? We talk about refugees. Who's a refugee? People have an idea that they know, but if you start breaking it down, it's a lot of different categories of people with a lot of different rights and obligations and opportunities and barriers to those opportunities that are not out in the open when we just talk about labor migrants. So when does migration, or when might it become an issue in the public debate? I think when we stop being precise on what we're talking about, when we don't have the numbers, when we just talk about migration without going back to the numbers, or when we stop asking our civil servants to count. Because if we don't know what we're talking about, then how can you make a sound political statement on your policies and their meaning for a society?
And maybe we can look at these different categories. For instance, I'm a citizenship teacher, not only a philosophy teacher. One question I often ask my students is, we always talk about migrants, immigrants coming to the Netherlands. Do you think one or the other, so their motive maybe, is important whether or not they deserve certain privileges or not? So does someone who comes to the Netherlands because of political reasons deserve more rights than someone who comes to the Netherlands because of poverty, and someone who comes here to study? Maybe you can give your view a bit on these questions.
Yeah, so that question goes to two levels. One is, what rights should they have, which of course, or do you think they should have, is as a philosopher, I see how that is a relevant question. I like to look at what rights people actually have, and maybe to what extent those rights are limited in a way that they shouldn't be limited because of, you know, international human rights frameworks. So if somebody comes in as a student or as a refugee, let's take those two as a comparison. If you come as a student to Europe, there's a European directive that says what your rights are. One of the things that you don't have is a right to family reunification. As a student, you don't. Somebody who comes as a refugee and does get status for protection in the EU is entitled to family migration. If they apply for family migration within 3 months of getting their status, they actually get facilitated family migration. Less conditions apply. They don't have to prove that they have sufficient income to support their family, for instance, because we don't expect them to be able to have such resources for the first 3 months after obtaining their status. So there we have the human rights discourse, where we say it's a human right for the refugee to be reunited with their family and build a new life together within our borders. And that's actually language taken from the Family Reunification Directive, also an EU instrument stimulating family migration, which actually says having a family is a very important element. Having your family with you helps you integrate. So the fact that students are not entitled to family migration sort of shows how we hinge still on the old notion that students are only here temporarily and are supposed to return. And the new notion is that we actually want to keep them. But if we want to keep them, if we want to integrate them, that is strange that we don't allow them to have their families with them.
Mm-hmm.
So they have different rights when they arrive. If we continue, when you talk of citizenship, of the right to remain, for instance, students, the periods that they stay in European country, count, the years count for half. So a student who has been here for 4 years can take two of those years towards permanent residence, which has to be a total of 5 years. A refugee right now has to wait for 5 years and then they're eligible for permanent residence. But a very interesting thing of the Migration Pact is that it suggests that in the future, people who have received protection should actually be eligible for permanent residence after 3 years. So in that sense, they will be more deserving of a more secure residence status. It's not citizenship yet. That's a national mm-hmm. prerogative to decide who gets citizenship. But long-term residence, that's a right under EU law. And now the pact suggests, while students have to wait double time, refugees should wait less years, and 3 years might be sufficient for them to be eligible for permanent residence. So in law, we make these distinctions. And there's political reasons behind that, economic, social, well, all sorts of reasons why we make these kind of decisions on entitlements.
What I found striking about your observation that there were two levels in my question was that you said, well, there's this distinction between what rights migrants should have and what rights they do have. And we're focusing on what they do have. I think there's also a level of what they should have in there. I immediately thought about the contribution you made to the public debate when there was a discussion about migrants working in the meat industry in the Netherlands. They work here and they work really hard under dire circumstances. And I believe you suggested, well, maybe we should improve those circumstances. Is that correct?
Yeah. The issue became more obvious because of the COVID-19 crisis. But it's actually, yeah, say an issue that has been here for far longer. The group of people that we are probably talking about, but this is something I'm still embarking on research to study further, who we're talking about, but it's likely that most of them are EU nationals. So while I was previously talking about international students and refugees, those are people from outside the EU coming to the EU. But when we talk about the people we see work, for instance, in the meat industry, it's probably EU nationals. As EU nationals, they have citizenship of the European Union, and that's a strong set of rights. They have a right to free movement as workers. They can take up a job anywhere in the EU. That's a very strong position. The other third country nationals can usually not move that easily. But although they have a strong right to move, to work elsewhere, that doesn't say that they know what rights they have as a worker in the place of destination. So having a strong legal status within the EU doesn't necessarily mean you have good access to your rights. And I think if we look at what happened in the meat industry during the COVID-19 period, for what we know right now, what became clear is that a lot of the workers were seconded through employment agencies, and there are a lot of employment agencies who have tried their best to take good care of their workers, but there is a small group of agencies who don't care that much, but care about making money at the cost of workers. And what you see is that workers through the employment agencies are placed at different plants. And the plant owner doesn't really know who's working in their plant. They hardly have the names. They don't know where the people sleep. They know the agencies they work with, but they have sort of outsourced responsibility for their workers. And that creates a situation where at least in some segments of the labor market, nobody feels responsible for these workers. And as a result, we had Romanian migrant workers working in the Netherlands or in Germany or crossing the border up and down at great risk for infection in their place of work. Nobody felt responsible of informing them, or information that was out there wasn't available in a language accessible to them. I think on government websites by now, half a year later, we have information at least in English, and some government websites also have information in other languages. But the first press conferences, there was not a little banner on your screen saying, do you want information in Arabic, Polish, Romanian? Please visit this website. No, in part, the Dutch government, at least in the beginning, failed to inform widely. But I must also add, what exactly happened is something that we're going to study for the next 2 years, because we received a grant from the Dutch Research Council to actually look into this.
But your conclusion is at the moment is that migrants, they have rights, they aren't always aware of their rights and how to defend them. And there's maybe a responsibility for the government to better inform those migrants.
Yes, I think that's a good summary, although you could question whether it's always the government who's responsible. So I think it's a very important thing that we talk about who is responsible for properly informing the workers. It could also be the agencies, it could be the plants where they're working. So there's a wide group of actors involved.
And is this problem limited to those who work in lower paid jobs, or do highly skilled migrants, for instance, also face these kind of problems?
That's a good point. And I would say yes, higher skilled migrants could well face similar problems. Of course, the kind of work that they do is likely to differ. So what the meat plants physically have people work close mm-hmm. to each other. If you're an IT specialist working at a bank, you were probably working from home as of March 2020. So then this social distancing wasn't that much of an issue. So highly skilled migrant workers, often office workers, would be less at a risk in that respect. What we did see is that they were at risk for unemployment because a lot of companies had to let people go. And if you have to let people go, possibly it was these that were told to leave first. I haven't seen the data on this. So this is typically something, and I've seen you do that in your previous blogs, where you ask, okay, what should we investigate for the future? I think investigating into the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic on high-skilled migration is very needed. And I would suppose that high-skilled migrant workers might be the first to be laid off.
Is that because they maybe as well aren't that aware of their rights, or because of discrimination? Because if they're highly skilled, why wouldn't you keep them and maybe sack the Dutch employees?
Yeah, good point. Indeed, being knowledgeable of their rights is, I think, one issue. I think language, we're speaking English right now, we're teaching in English, a lot of stuff is happening in English in the Netherlands, I still think that learning Dutch is an absolute necessity to be successful on the Dutch labor market or as an entrepreneur in the Netherlands. You need to have at least some basic knowledge of the language. And I would say newcomers, be it refugees, be it our Romanian workers in the meat plants, be it our Indian expat, should all be offered language courses for free. This is so important for creating a society, for being together, living together, to share at least a basic knowledge of a language. And it's not being done. I mean, the Indian IT people don't have to learn the language. They're exempted from all the integration courses, etc. Refugees and family migrants, we force, and we're allowed to force them. So again, these categories I was talking about earlier, with the different rights they have and the different obligations. Here you see a very clear example of the different rights and obligations with regard to learning the language. And some are not, don't have to, and others, potential sanctions for not learning the language. And I would say offer everybody more prominent and free access to language courses. You mentioned labor market discrimination. Only just yesterday, there was a report on research showing that people with a migration background, especially people with a so-called non-Western migration background, have experienced COVID or have experienced less job opportunities or have been laid off more during COVID. And yes, then that would go for highly, and it's about highly skilled as well. The thing is that this study is on people with a migration background. And those are very likely to be Dutch people. I don't know how about you, but I have a migration background according to the statistics. So whenever there's talk of people with a migration background, I'm included. My mother was born abroad, and that is enough for labeling me as somebody with a migration background. That means that we are almost, at least a lot of people in the Netherlands are people of a migration background. So if you read that highly skilled people with a migration background experience trouble, discrimination, whatever, this could very well be people with a Dutch passport. And if that's not elaborated, again, my point, what is the message you're trying to convey if you're not making that distinction? So when I talk about highly skilled migration, like the Indian ICT, these are people with a non-citizens who experience all kind of trouble. If you talk about people with a migration background, you might just be talking about Dutch people. And as a migration lawyer, that's a very important distinction to make.
Yeah, I guess that also as a philosopher, because then it doesn't make it a problem with migrants, but a problem, a Dutch problem with Dutch citizens.
Yeah.
I want to take you back a little bit to the example we just discussed about the people working in the meat industry. And for those listeners who aren't aware of this, the Netherlands is second only to the USA in the export of meat. So it's a huge industry here in the Netherlands. And you said, well, a lot of those immigrants aren't aware of their rights. And I'm not sure where I read it, but I read an article where they interviewed immigrants working in the meat industry. And they said they were aware of their rights, but they were afraid of talking about it, addressing it, because they were afraid of being laid off, being sacked because of being too critical. So is the problem the rights and how aware people are of the rights? Or maybe there's also other factors which we should take into account, maybe class or power categories, which aren't necessarily visible when we talk about rights.
Yeah, that's a good point. And I think I said, when we talked about responsibility of informing people of their rights, I said that there's a wide group of actors that is responsible. And linking to talking of who's responsible, it's of course also gets to the point, do migrant workers know who to turn to? And indeed, you're right. If they why they didn't report in sick is because if you are working for an employment agency and you report in sick, you are less protected under the law than if you would be a full worker employed by a plant where you would be working. So, and that is again in our law on the working for employment agencies where this is allowed. Also, employment agencies are responsible in most cases for housing, for transport. So there's multiple dependencies on this one agency. If you report in sick, you don't just lose your work and your income, but you also lose your housing. So yes, you're right. It makes people afraid to report in sick. And especially in a pandemic, I would say that would immediately require action to prevent that people continue going to work out of fear of the consequences of calling in sick, which means there should be some sort of, I don't know, precautionary measure through a fund, through separate housing provided for those who fell sick, etc. But we were slow in setting up safeguards, and not just to safeguard the migrant workers we're talking about. You are also talking about your own communities, where they live, where they shop, where they commute through, we were, well, astonished that it took quite some time for this risk to be addressed. And still, I guess there could be more. There's more to be done to address this. And if I may, your introduction to the question to talk about this again was also to the listeners. You mentioned, well,
Europe, but the U.S. exports more meat, so we're 22nd to the U.S.
Yeah. Well, yay! And we're a very small country, so that sort of.
Yeah.
We're packed with with animals in a way, but that's a question at a different level. So mm-hmm. we've been talking about the migrant workers and their rights and their fears, but you could also wonder why we have decided to allow for this sector to be this large, if it is a sector that is so heavily relying on migrant labor to perform this huge production.
So that's also something that strikes me when I look at the European Pact. Obviously, I have a superficial understanding of it, but when I look at how migration as a theme is discussed and the policy that Europe has on it, it also is, to me, and maybe I'm totally wrong here, but it seems a bit superficial. There used to be quotas, there aren't quotas anymore. We're just talking about migration in the abstract sense. And even now there's a lot of critique, for instance, from Hungary, the Czech Republic, Poland. They say, yeah, that's an improvement. We don't have to look at quotas and we'll just send those migrants away. But it would even be better if we wouldn't have to send them away. We should be clear and not allow any migrants in. It all seems a little bit too superficial when you don't take into account the economics, the rights of these people.
Yeah, I agree that there's a lot of border talk in the pact. It's a lot of borders and a lot of externalizing our borders. And engaging our partners, international partners, the neighborhood, in being our external border guard. But if you go through the first paragraph of the pact, there's also mention of the need for innovation, the need for migrants for economic reasons, the demographic development in the EU, which means we're actually a shrinking population. And if we want to keep up produce based on the same number of employees, we actually need migrants. And mm-hmm. that's actually in the opening of the opening paragraph. So
that's how superficial my understanding is.
Yeah, no, that's okay. That's okay. Because if you read on, it's a lot of border talk. So in that sense, you're right. But I picked up on the little links that it does give for, say, the economic need, seeing the economic need of the EU for migration. And it is addressed. One that I really like is what I said at the beginning, is that in the future, one of the things it proposes is that people who receive protection, refugees, will be eligible for a long-term residence permit after 3 years instead of 5 years. It also says that in the future, it would like to change this right to include a right to be mobile in the EU, meaning that if somebody gets refugee status in Italy and after 3 years gets a permanent residence status, if they find a job elsewhere in the EU, they can go elsewhere to perform that job. So they become mobile like EU citizens have mobility rights. I find that a positive one, and I find that from an economic perspective, a wise change, because it increases the workforce across Europe without having to ask people from Africa to come here for work reasons. No, there are already plenty of people here, possibly, to actually perform jobs instead of us asking people to come from further away to perform those jobs.
Okay, yeah. And there, I said there isn't any talk about quota anymore. There used to be. So the idea was that there should be a just allocation of refugees in one country and in the other country, and they shouldn't all be in Italy and Greece, for instance. And obviously Hungary and also Austria were highly critical of it. You're also critical of quota, I believe. Maybe you could also tell the listeners why you're critical of quota.
yeah, but my critique on quota is on a
different totally
type.
Different level.
Different type of quota, although maybe some of the general issues can be copied into the refugee quota talk. The thing with quota is, in general, whether we talk about refugees or labor migrants or otherwise, is that they send a message. Again, it's a number. A number sends a message. And people have the feeling that something is in control or out of control because of the number. Numbers are not always filled. So if you say, okay, we're getting 100 people, but these 100 people need to qualify such and such and such, it might mean that only 40 people qualify. But the idea is 100, although in fact it might be 40. But if there is 400 people who fit this qualification, maybe with less political upheaval, a quota will be raised, and it might actually be 100 or 200 or 300 people coming. And I base this on, we talked about my PhD. In my PhD, I mapped the quota talks on guest workers coming to the Netherlands. And first it was 40, and then businesses knocked on the door of government and said, no, but we need 100. Okay, so that you get 60 more. It was never set in stone how many people would actually come. And if business wanted more, the quota were raised. We've seen something similar more recent with Asian chefs, totally different category, haven't mentioned them yet, but we have across Europe, a lot of countries have specific policy to recruit Asian chefs because Asian cuisine is apparently something that we either cannot do properly or people want work in Asian restaurants, whatever. I know Sweden has a separate policy, Germany has separate policy, we, the Netherlands, have a policy on chefs. And we used to have quota for chefs. But then if the quota was full, but one of the big fancy Asian restaurants still needed a cook, the quota was raised. And maybe another example on quota, Europe has a policy on seasonal migrant labor, seasonal workers from outside the EU. Europe allows all the member states to have volumes of admission, is how they call it, quota. So the Netherlands said, okay, so we'll have seasonal workers quota zero. We don't want people from outside the EU to work in our seasonal sectors.
Yeah,
that's what was political debate was zero. It was never made into law. We don't have a law saying zero, but nobody applies. Because nobody studies the law, people remember the debate.
Yeah.
Think it's zero because that was how it was debated. But there's no law saying you can't apply. So a quota is also something in the mind.
Yeah, it's more image than it's reality,
yes.
Is it?
Yes.
Yeah.
My summary.
Yeah, it ties into a famous saying by Jacques Delors, who's one of the most important politicians in the European project, the European Union. And he says, when people, politicians here come to the European Union, they talk about things and then in the media, they say something completely different. And the idea is when you look tough, people will respect you more. You will get more votes, for instance. And Jacques Delors calls that mauvaise pédagogique. My French isn't that great, but bad education to the people, because the thing you're signaling is, well, migration is a problem, when in reality, you know, it isn't a problem. You're just acting like it's a problem. So you look tough and like a good politician for your people.
Yeah, I couldn't have said it better.
And this ties into another topic I wanted to discuss with you, because in our preparation, we talked about the migration crisis. At least I used the term migration crisis, and you reacted, well, maybe you're talking about 2015, but according to me, there never really was a migration crisis. So I think that would listeners would want to know more about that.
Well, I think you actually just to some extent summed it up. What we've seen is that bureaucracies were not prepared to receive the Syrian refugees. We knew what was happening in Syria. So you could have seen it coming that there would be some people from Syria who might not like to stay there. So you could prepare for that. You could have beds ready for them. You'd scale up your reception centers. You could scale up the staff. If this is something that you can prepare for, you can have some spare beds ready at all time. And of course, there's a balance. You can't have spare beds ready all the time for 100,000 people, because then that's relatively costly. But you could think of, okay, what is a reasonable number of spare beds that we should have available for reception centers in case of emergency? So I would say the crisis was not so much migration, but the crisis was reception. Mm-hmm. And who's responsible? It's not a migration crisis. It's a bureaucracy crisis, a management crisis of not wanting to see and manage to obvious developments in migration into the EU or into the Netherlands.
So we have the capacity, if we would prepare, to take migrants in, but we do not prepare.
Yeah, we're a very well-organized country. We have a very large population who is very welcoming to migrants. And I mean, once the Syrian refugees arrived, I think the reception centers were equally flooded by volunteers and toys presented by kids who wanted to share our welfare with the newly received refugees. And you also often see that people, you know, first protest, oh, we don't want a reception center for refugees. But once they're there, a couple of years later, if the center is closed, people are actually sad that they're leaving. We're good at organizing things. We're good at welcoming.
Before we go to further recommendations, I have some statements which I think at least it seems like a lot of people believe in them, and maybe you could debunk them because I think they are false. So one of them is most migrants enter by the Mediterranean Sea on a rubber boat.
False, yeah. Most migrants come, well, one, what is a migrant?
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, two, I think most people fly in with a visa or because they're visa-free travel, like labor migrants, family migrants. And when I talk about family migrants, most of them are the family members of Dutch people, if we look at the Netherlands. And I could go on. False, yeah.
Tying into that, maybe most migrants come to the Netherlands or Europe because of poverty. Probably too superficial, at least.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, cause for nuance. But for instance, the people who live in true poverty across the globe don't have money to migrate. It is a very costly trip across Iran or Turkey, Afghanistan, wherever people come from. Maybe I wanted to make a recommendation for further reading. In this respect, it might be very good to read Gun Island from Amitav Ghosh, an Indian author, and to answer the question on who and what does it cost to sit in one of these rubber boats to cross the Mediterranean. It's definitely not the most poor.
Well, maybe the last statement I have here is migration is a threat. And that we didn't talk about culture that much. We talked about who is Dutch, so that ties into it, and that might complicate things. But is migration a threat?
I think that's a very personal experience. I don't experience it as a threat, but like I said, I have a migration background myself. I enjoy the cultural experience of exchange with people with different cultures. I think a lot of people in the Netherlands like to eat Chinese food. Pasta is definitely on the table in most houses once a week, and we can thank our Italian guest workers for bringing us pasta. So I see migration as a fact and as a richness of culture.
I think I learned a lot about migration, and I hope the listeners also learned a lot about migration. But what if they want to learn more about migration? Do you have three things you would recommend to them to maybe read or watch to learn more about migration or other topics we discussed?
First, on the Center for Migration Law, of which I'm the director, our center, research center in migration, we have on our website a link to a lot of movies, books, clips, etc. on migration. So I would advise anybody who wants to know more about it to scroll through that and watch some of the movies, documentaries, etc. On a same level of more general information, I've mentioned Gun Island. There's two other novels that I've read the past years that I love their angle to migration. They're both by John Lancaster. One is Capital and the other one is The Wall. And they both indirectly discuss the impact of migration. So that's on a more general note. I've talked a little bit about data, about numbers, and about policies. I love the work by Hein de Haas on these matters. So people who want to study more of the numbers and of the effects of policies should definitely look into his work. He's a professor of sociology at the University of Amsterdam. And about industries and how they're organized, the economics of how we want to produce what it is that we are needing. So, and that's, I think, a global issue that the pandemic has really put out there, that we need to think of trade relations, production processes. Why do we need to eat so much meat as we do? And to go back to that example.
I'm a vegan, so I would say eat none. But
okay, so I have quite some family members who are a vegetarian and indeed also vegan, but that's an interesting thought. Why is that not coming across more strongly, that we can change a little bit of the world as consumers? And how does that interrelate with migration and migrant rights? Yeah. Because I think there's a very strong relation there and we're not seeing it or not looking at it good enough yet.
Yeah.
And of course, with my own research, I hope to contribute to a better understanding of these interrelations.
Yeah, more understanding and focus on the interrelations and the complexities of immigration.
Yeah, sounds good.
Okay, Tessa Lange, I thank you for this very interesting conversation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and good luck with the series.
For more information about the research of Tesseltje de Lange, links, recommendations, research information services and show notes, please visit futurebased.org. If you have inquiries or want to comment on this podcast, please feel free to reach out to Floris@futurebased.org. Thank you.